Wallach on Law examines criminal cases and criminal justice and asks the question, we are tough on crime, but is that helping? Can we be smarter and make us safer?
You want answers!
I want the truth! You can't handle the truth!
Ian Wallach is a criminal defense attorney and civil rights lawyer in Los Angeles and New York. His cases have ranged from defense of the accused to the prosecution of governments in their treatment of convicts. He's a former Los Angeles deputy public defender and a frequent contributor on legal issues to radio and television shows nationwide.
You're out of order. The whole trial is out of order.
You're going to need a bigger boat.
This country, our courts are the great levelers. In our courts, all men are created equal.
This is Wallach on Law. Here's your host, Ian Wallach.
Hello, everybody. Thank you and welcome. Welcome to this week's edition of Wallach on Law. I'm your host, Ian Wallach. Welcome to our new listeners and our new territories. Very glad to have you here and have you join this conversation. Today, we're going to be talking about life and death in Arizona. We're going to be talking about the Jody Arias trial, Jody Arias, and also death by lethal injection. And talking about Arizona specifically, there's a couple of different legal proceedings that we're going to be talking about. Now, the trial, the guilt or innocence part of the trial of Jody Arias, that's over. So now what's on the horizon is the determination of the sentence that she might face. It's either going to be life in prison or it's going to be death by lethal injection. Now, the trial of Jody Arias is one that captivated the nation, and potentially because it was salacious or morbid curiosity, or because the facts were so horrid, or because she was so strange. But for some reason, this became perhaps the most publicized trial of the decade, and through media coverage, we were actually allowed almost as though we were in the courtroom of that trial. We could click on and watch the proceedings in almost every regard and almost at every moment. But to discuss the Jody Arias trial, and to discuss Jody Arias herself, we are welcoming Jane Velez Mitchell. Now, Jane Velez Mitchell is probably more suited to discuss Jody Arias than anyone else. She covers it regularly on her daily show. It's her nationally syndicated show, The Jane Velez Mitchell Show on HLN. She's written a book about Jody Arias. It's a New York Times bestseller. It's Exposed, the Secret Life of Jody Arias. Her credits, of course, are ongoing. She's a contributor to CNN, to E! She's an award-winning journalist, and she was kind enough to take some of her time and join us today and provide insight into Jody Arias, and not only that, also into her backstory, Jody Arias' backstory, her nature, and even give us some things that we can learn from Jody Arias and from Jody Arias' trial. And all this is happening as Jody Arias' sentencing is on the horizon. Now, as we said, she's already been convicted of murdering Travis Alexander, and the only thing that's left to be determined, which is going to be determined by a new jury, is whether she should spend her life in prison, life imprisonment, or die by lethal injection. But here's a problem. Lethal injection is also a hot topic in Arizona. Agreeably, not as hot a topic as Jody Arias, but it is definitely in the people are talking about it right now because of another legal proceeding that took place, and this one took place on July 23rd, and this was the botched execution of Joseph Wood, and this was the fourth botched execution of 2014, all of which have been by lethal injection, and about 7% of executions over the past few years, executions by lethal injection, have not gone as planned. The execution of Mr. Wood took over 2 hours instead of minutes. It was apparently exceptionally disturbing to watch, and also, as I think we're going to learn, it didn't have to be. Following the execution of Mr. Wood, Eric Holder, the Attorney General for the United States, called for the disclosure of the death cocktails. These are the medicines and the combinations of medicines that are used by states to execute individuals. Well, to learn about lethal injection, and also to learn specifically about the execution of Mr. Wood, we're going to welcome Dale Baich. Now, Dale Baich is a federal public defender. He was Mr. Wood's capital attorney. He was appointed about 10 months prior to the July 23rd execution, and he's going to walk us through the process of death by lethal injection, the risk. He's going to talk about the lack of transparency and the need for it that exists in this governmental business of the taking of human life. He's going to tell you what he saw. He's going to share his thoughts. And he's going to let us know that he's going to talk to us about if we're going to do this, what we need to do to make the process safer, and not just safer for the individuals whose life is being taken, but safer for the witnesses, and also safer for the citizens in whose name a life is being taken. So thank you for joining us, and let's talk about Arizona. Now, Jane Velez Mitchell is an award-winning television journalist and a best-selling author. She currently has her own show on HLN, Jane Velez Mitchell. It was formerly known as Issues with Jane Velez Mitchell. She's a guest host on Nancy Grace. She is nationally recognized. She's frequently in the media as an expert commentator on high-profile cases. She appears on CNN, on HLN, Insider, True TV, E! She's the author of several books, including the number five New York Times bestseller, Exposed, The Secret Life of Jody Arias, and she is kind enough to be with us today. Jane Velez Mitchell, thank you so much for joining my show. Thank you.
Well, Ian, it's a delight. I'm so happy to be on your show today and talk about my book, which is Exposed, The Secret Life of Jody Arias. It's coming out in paperback, or you can also get it on Kindle, and it is the definitive account of this mesmerizing case that doesn't seem to ever end. I mean, this poor man, Travis Alexander, was viciously murdered in 2008. Here we are.
Right.
Heading into the fall of 2014, family of his still does not have closure.
And we don't even know if they're ultimately going to get closure. Certainly, what's at issue right now is the life or the death sentence. Is that pretty much where we are?
Essentially, she was convicted of first-degree murder, mm-hmm. and the jury hung on whether to kill her with lethal injection or to give her life. And so what happened is that was a hung jury on the penalty phase. And so they have decided, the prosecution has decided to retry her on that penalty phase. And they're going to have to choose an entirely new jury, which in a case
right.
that's gotten such national coverage is going to be a challenge.
Sure.
So many people have heard about Jody Arias and they have very strong opinions. The court of public opinion very much against Jody Arias because of the horrific nature of the crime that she committed, and that there is no dispute that she committed it. She doesn't even deny. She,
yeah.
you know, she told three stories. First, she said, "I wasn't there." Then she said, two ninjas came in masks, a man and a woman, and did it. And I escaped and I ran out. And then when that story was completely unbelievable, after thinking about it a couple of years behind bars awaiting trial, she came out with a third defense, which was self-defense. And she proceeded to assassinate the character of Travis Alexander, insinuating he was everything from a pedophile to a complete sexual deviant. And that's one of the reasons that this case just got so much publicity, because people couldn't believe what was coming out of this woman's mouth. She took the witness stand for 18 days and essentially hijacked the trial. Prosecutor Juan Martinez did a great job confronting her and trying to tear down her lies. In the book, I establish how she is a pathological liar. And I look at her backstory. I look at her childhood. I look at what made this woman into the person she became, capable of what she did.
Now, did you come to a determination that it was a psychological disorder or just a terrible personality? I mean, the fact that she did it, this sentencing phase of the trial, that has nothing to do with the fact she did this. It's been determined by a jury.
There were photographs. Another reason that this case is so fascinating is that there were photographs taken before and during and after the crime. And there were naked photos of her and Travis. And some incredibly graphic photos. Then there were photos of her taking photos of Travis Alexander, the Mormon who was her ex-boyfriend that she was visiting in Mesa, Arizona. And she has photos that she's taking of him in the shower, sort of Calvin Kleinish type photos. And she said, at one point, I wanted to take those kinds of photos of him. And then there were inadvertent photos of the crime in progress. And even what's believed to be her leg dragging his body, either lifeless or about to become lifeless. So that's extraordinary. And she took the camera and she put in a washing machine and she put the washing machine on. But the police were able to extricate the SIM card. And thanks to some incredible detective work, they managed to find those photos and fixed that SIM card enough so that those photos came out crystal clear and were shown to the jury.
Do you think this show captured such national attention because of the disturbing nature of her personality, the sick nature of the crime, the empathetic nature of the victim? Or what was it that made this trial in particular so gripping nationally for such an extended period of time?
Well, I think it was everything. It was the, first of all, the incredibly graphic sexual aspects.
Sure.
She recorded a phone sex conversation that she and Travis Alexander had that is triple X-rated. I was sitting in court at one point. It was played many, many times during the trial, or at least a number of times. And I was sitting once when it was played, and it's just so embarrassing. Like, it's like the entire courtroom's blushing because they climax. There's incredibly graphic things said during this conversation. And in my book, Expose, The Secret Life of Jody Arias, I present the theory, which I think I have a lot of good backing for, that she surreptitiously recorded this in order to blackmail him, as she claims that he asked her to. But there's no indication that he's aware that the tape recording is being made when he's talking. And why would a man who's a Mormon,
sure,
and who wants to succeed in the Mormon community encourage somebody to audiotape him during an incredibly triple X-rated phone sex session? It doesn't pass the smell test, Salem, because he was going to take another girl on a vacation to Cancun with their mutual friends, and she didn't want that to happen. It is my belief she didn't. She claims that she didn't care, but I think otherwise. And I believe that, and we lay out in the book that we believe that this was a blackmail tape, and that one of the reasons that she ended up killing him is that she may have let him know. She may have let him know that she did this, and
if he still didn't take her, then forget it. Right, but blackmail can come in many forms. I mean, people can blackmail for money. They can blackmail simply because they want to have, you know, power over a relationship. And she seems to be a very power obsessed individual. And I think that was clear throughout the trial. Would you disagree with that? Or?
Yeah, I mean, look, the prosecution said she had borderline personality disorder. And so borderline personality disorder is absolutely fascinating. Now, the defense argued that she didn't, but mm-hmm. I think that was stupid. I think that they would have been better off to embrace the prosecution's theory, because at least it wouldn't make her just look like pure evil. It would make her look like she was suffering from a mental defect of some sort. But borderlines are fascinating, and this is one of the reasons why I think this book is really educational. All of us deal with I would say mild versions of these extreme behavioral dysfunctions every day. We all know people in our lives who just don't know boundaries. You know, they don't hear no, they come over unannounced, they stay too long, or they're
sure.
in your business. Well, this is the extreme example. This is a woman who really stalked her boyfriend, essentially. And then when he wanted to extricate himself from the relationship and they officially broke up, she moved from California to Mesa, Arizona, and set up shop just a couple of minutes from his house, and then proceeded to insinuate himself into his life as he was trying to move on. Now, you know, even his own friends will admit, you know, when she was around, he did have sex with her, and mm-hmm. that was a character defect. And they say he was like an addict, that she was a drug to him, that when she offered herself in essentially a sexual fire sale, that he didn't say no. But
it's not the first time
that doesn't mean
that,
you
that
should be able to be stabbed 29 times.
Absolutely. And it's not the first time in history that crazy people have connected with people that they find attractive who they also recognize are unstable. I mean, sadly, it's not an uncommon experience. It's just so nightmarish when it went to the ends that it did in this case. You had written in the past.
Yeah.
Oh, sorry.
No, I was going to say about borderline personality disorder, which I really do believe she has. What they do is they deify someone. And that's exactly what she did. She deified, sexually and in other ways, Travis Alexander. And then when the object of their obsession ultimately is incapable of fulfilling their insatiable desires and needs for more and more attention and more affection, they turn on them and then they demonize them. So it's black and white thinking. Either you're a god, either you're the most amazing person on the planet, or you're this demon and you're a horrible person. And you see in the book Exposed, we essentially show how she goes through this arc of worshiping this man and then demonizing him to the point that she slashes his throat ear to ear, stabs him 29 times,
right.
and then just for good measure shoots him in the head.
Which is nightmarish, which is garish. Is there anything that you think we can actually learn from Jody Arias or from the relationship between Jody Arias and Trevor?
Absolutely.
What can we learn?
Absolutely. I didn't write this book just to wallow in gratuitous violence. You can learn a lot by seeing this kind of human dysfunction, because there were warning signs. His friends warned him and said, Travis, watch out. There's something wrong with this woman. We're begging you. Don't have anything to do with her. And he couldn't stop himself. Like his friend said, it was like a drug. When she presented herself to him sexually, he couldn't say no. And so the lesson is that when one person says something about somebody you're involved with, well, maybe they're wrong. But when six or seven people say it,
then it's time to step up the plate and listen. Let me ask you about, there's definitely some issues, and she's going to be, you know, before a jury, they're all they're going to be selected of individuals, once they find them, who are going to be on board for the death penalty if they think that's appropriate. That's sort of the standards, one of the standards that this of this pool that we to get onto the jury to decide whether she lives or dies. Arizona's had some problems with the death penalty this year. Do you think that might interfere with the jury's outcome?
Well, let me say this. I think that it's very possible that the prosecutor could snatch defeat from the jaws of victory here. I don't have any statistical evidence because I don't think it's been studied to that degree, or there's such a large pool of women on death row that you could really have this kind of study. But I think that a lot of people feel that there's a bias against putting women to death. Just like there mm-hmm. are certain biases toward putting certain elements of our society to death, which is unfortunate. It should be a completely unbiased process. In fact, I personally am not in favor of the death penalty. I'm not in favor of violence as a solution to violence at all.
Thank you very much. By the way, let me thank you very much for saying that. It's a very admirable stake. It's one I wish we would hear more of, because it certainly doesn't function as a deterrent in any way. I don't see how it brings closure in any way. But just thank you for sharing that. Thank you.
Yeah, I mean, listen, I'm a vegan. I don't eat meat. I don't wear leather products. Why would I advocate putting somebody to death? That's not my philosophy. My philosophy is one of nonviolence in whenever possible, except in cases of self-defense, generally, although I don't want to make such a blanket statement. Sometimes one has to do what one has to do in certain circumstances. It's very hard to make black and white pronouncements about such a large and amorphous subject, but that being said, Prosecutor Juan Martinez did a great job. He won a conviction.
He did a great job. He had a lot to work with.
Next phase is going to be a lot trickier. It's going to be a lot trickier. All she has to get is one juror.
That's right.
And so the odds of that happening, of her bonding with one juror, especially if indeed she ultimately ends up representing herself, and she is asked to do that, but it goes back and forth. I mean, that's the way it stands as we speak right now. For all I know, by the time this airs, it'll be different, because she had represented herself for about a week back in 2011, and she realized that she was in over her head. She just got her GED behind bars. She has no legal.
It's a terrifying idea for anybody to do. They at least need standby counsel.
Yeah.
It's a terrifying idea.
Yeah. So who knows? You know, when the first day opens of this case, what the situation is going to be, but she has indicated a desire to represent herself, so that might increase her chances of bonding with one of the jurors, because instead of just sitting there at the defense table, she can now really interact and try to spin that.
And she's capable
of
being
manipulative.
She's very manipulative. She's very compelling, even with everything, you know, hideous that she's done. She's able to present herself as, you know, sort of bright and sort of perky. She's able to I don't want to say sort of act flirtatious, but she's able to make a connection with people. And all she needs is one, as you said earlier. And she might be able to hit a home run and save her life in this upcoming hearing.
Yeah. So it's going to be interesting. It's going to be fascinating. And I really feel for the family of Travis Alexander that they have to go through this again. And especially if she does hijack the case again, which I really feel she'll try to do. She loves attention.
Sure.
And she's very good at thinking on her feet. I mean, if you watch the police interrogation tapes where she basically makes up a story about ninjas out of whole cloth.
She's crazy.
Right,
I mean,
off the top of her head.
And believe and it would work. It is unbelievable. It's fascinating.
The audacity. And then, you know, her bizarre behavior. She did a headstand in the interrogation room. She did this weird sexual backbend. She sang various songs. I think you can't make this up.
You can't make a lot of it up. I have seen, I mean, you know, I've been doing, you know, criminal defense for years. A lot of my practice is indigent practice. I think a lot of people, when they get nervous, when they're under suspicion, engage in acts that look suspicious, and, or at least to an officer's eye, make them, you know, want to look a little further. But in this case, it was way beyond, I think, anything that most people had seen before.
Yeah, well, you know, just when you've seen everything, something else comes along. And I've covered some of the most really bizarre and high-profile cases in memory, from O.J. Simpson to Michael Jackson to Robert Blake, Casey Anthony, George Zimmerman. I mean, each one of them was bizarre and different in its own way. But this one, I would have to say, just in terms of her 18 days on the stand and the sex tape played in court, and the photos from the camera of a crime in progress, a hideous murder in progress, inadvertent photos that were preceded by incredibly graphic, gynecologically graphic sexual photos.
Sure.
I mean, it really is a mind blower. And what I do in the book, Expose the Secret Life of Jody Arias, which is now out in paperback, and you can also get downloaded on Kindle or any of your devices, is weave in Travis Alexander's story and Jody Arias' story from their childhood all the way up to the verdict, and interweave the investigation. So it's one chapter on Jody, then a chapter on the investigation, then a chapter on Travis, then a chapter on the investigation progressing. And the sum total of it is that I have to say, because I just reread it since it's coming out in paperback, it's fascinating. I couldn't put it down because I'm not patting myself on the back.
No, you should. It's a great accomplishment. And enough people in America loved it.
The facts are so extraordinary. This woman, after slitting his throat and stabbing him 29 times, leaves him a voicemail inviting him to go see Othello. She says, hey, you know, words to the effect of, hey, a friend of mine and I are going to go to see Shakespeare, and we'd love you to come and join us for Othello. She just stabbed him.
It's, I mean, unbelievable.
It's beyond comprehension. She also goes to his memorial service, and she takes binders of photos, and she photos of her with him, photos of him, and she goes around to all the people, his friends and his family, tries to get them to sign the back of the photos so that she can hand that to the family as some sort of tribute, knowing that she's the one. And by that time, everybody suspected her because he had complained about his, quote, stalker ex-girlfriend, so who had slashed his tires, allegedly, and various other bizarre behavior. So by that time, everybody's looking at her like, what are you doing here? We think you're the one who killed him.
It's so disturbing. Hey, listen, in the last minute I have, you know, a jury's going to convene in September. They're going to think about it. I know you are inundated with lawyers, and you get to work with in Arizona right now. It's not the best time in light of what's happened recently. What do most of the lawyers that you speak with think the outcome's going to be? Not you, but what do most people think people, we're not supposed to make bets, but if they do, are more lawyers that you speak to expecting her to get the death penalty or expecting her to get life?
Well, here's the interesting thing about expert panelists and expert lawyers. Quite often they're wrong.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody thought Ginsburg was an open and shut case, right?
Mm-hmm.
Everybody
right.
thought that the prosecutor in that case did a brilliant job and Casey Anthony walked. So it's almost a contrarian indicator sometimes when everybody says, oh, yeah, this is a slam dunk for the prosecution. Watch out. And nobody knows what's going to happen in these cases. And honestly, anybody who says that they have a really good idea of what's going to happen is a fool. I mean, seriously, you don't know.
A really good guess. Right,
you don't know. And a lot, I think people inject their desires into their predictions. In other words, people who want her to go to the death penalty say, I think she's going to get the death penalty. People who don't want her to get the death penalty say, I don't think she's going to get it. I just don't really think at this stage.
That's the idea that people want affirmation over information. That is a...
Yeah.
Very frightening. So I didn't want to cut you off. If you had a final thought, I didn't want to cut you off. I'm so sorry.
No, I just think, I think that this is a cautionary tale in so many ways. It's about picking up on signals when people start telling you who they are. Pay attention. And I hope that by really outlining in extraordinary detail the backstory of these two individuals. Travis had a very tough life. His parents were drug addicts, and he was abused by his mother. He pulled himself up by his bootstraps from nothing. And to end this way is just such a waste. I mean, he was writing a memoir. He had a lot to give. And I just think that if people read this and they recognize certain dysfunctions and have commonalities with their own lives, that they can sort of have a light bulb go off and say to themselves, maybe I shouldn't do this. Maybe I should do that. That would be a great outcome from the book.
That sounds like a wonderful goal, and I hope that it happens for you. Jane Velez Mitchell, thank you so much for taking time out of your time to come join our show today. Our guest is Jane Velez Mitchell of her own show and also author of the book Exposed, The Secret Life of Jody Arias, which is out. You can also get it on Kindle, on paperback. It's a gripping read. Ms. Velez Mitchell, thank you for spending the time.
Well,
and helping
call me Jane, and I just want to say invite your listeners to watch us Monday through Thursday on HLN, 7 p.m. Eastern, and we're going to be covering the Jody Arias trial for sure, and the retrial, and we have fascinating stories every day, so I hope you join us.
Thank you so much.
Okay, bye.
So once again, welcome to Wallach on Law, and today we're going to be speaking about lethal injection. And to understand lethal injection a little bit better, we're going to be speaking with Dale Baich. Now, Mr. Baich is an assistant federal public defender. He is a supervising attorney in the capital habeas unit of his office, and this means he gets his clients come to him when they've already been sentenced to death. The appeals process is over, or at least over to some extent, and his job is to represent them from the moment that they've pretty been, the trials afterwards, and they've been condemned to die. Now, he's a member of the board of directors of the Arizona ACLU. He's a member of the advisory board of the Arizona Death Penalty Forum, and he's also a professor at the Sandra Day O'Connor College of the Law at Arizona State University. And he's been kind enough to take some of his time today to sort of help us understand this process. And he's incredibly suited to do that, especially because he was capital counsel to Joseph Wood. Now, Mr. Wood was executed recently, and this turned out to be the fourth botched execution of 2014. And he's here to help sort of understand the legal process and potentially its unexpected dangers and provide any other information that we can. Dale, thank you so much. Welcome to the show.
Thank you, Ian.
So I think, a lot of people, when you hear the words lethal injection, it doesn't sound like it should be all that difficult. You put aside your moral questions, just the actual process of it. But could you sort of help us understand, I guess from a chemical, from a medical perspective, how is this procedure supposed to end a human life?
Well, when Dr. Jay Chapman invented the lethal injection process back in 1977, he came up with a three-drug cocktail. Sodium thiopental would be the first drug that would be administered. The prisoner, after receiving that drug, would be in a sedated state. Then the next drug that was injected was pancuronium bromide, which is a paralytic, and that would paralyze the prisoner. And the final drug that was injected was potassium chloride, and that would stop the prisoner's heart. So there was this process in place where it
appeared. Do you know if each of those components had? I mean, you described the effect that they had, but what the purpose was it sort of a is the sedative so the body can't react? Is the sedative supposed to be so the person experiencing the injection feels less pain? Do you know what the...
Well, the sodium thiopental would anesthetize the person, so he would not feel pain. The paralytic then would paralyze the body so that the witnesses to the execution could not see movement by the prisoner during the execution process. And finally, the potassium chloride would stop the heart.
Would it be fair to say, or would it be a gross overgeneralization to say the first one is intended to be humane, to make the process of killing someone humane to the person being killed, that being the sedative? The paralytic, because is to make the process be more humane for the person watching the killing. Is that potentially correct, or do you have any thoughts on that?
Well, that would be a fair assessment. The prisons did not want the witnesses to see the prisoner moving when the drugs were being administered. For instance, the potassium chloride is very painful when it courses through a person's veins. It burns. So there might be a lot of movement when that drug was being administered. So the second drug would mask that by paralyzing the prisoner.
So the prisoner is arguably still experiencing these things. They're still having these pain, but it's just not visible to the people who are watching the execution take place.
Sure. If the first drug, the sodium thiopental, did not work properly or wore off prematurely, the prisoner would be experiencing pain, but the witnesses would not see it because the prisoner was paralyzed. But all of this changed in 2010 when the supply of sodium thiopental dried up. States were no longer able to obtain the domestic brand that was manufactured by Hospira, so they started to go overseas, obtained the drug from a distributor in the United Kingdom, and the drug was shipped to Arizona, Tennessee, Georgia, and other states. When we learned that the drug was being imported, we were concerned because under the Food, Drug, and Cosmetics Act, it's illegal to import a non-FDA-approved drug into the country. We raised that concern with the Department of Corrections in Arizona and with the Food and Drug Administration. We also filed a lawsuit against the FDA, and were successful. The D.C. Circuit Court of Appeals held that that it was illegal for the FDA to allow the drug into the country because it was a unapproved drug.
And I take it there was probably very little. I mean, there was no way. I don't know who would be able to do any type of, you know, quality monitoring or quality measuring or apply the same type of oversight that we see, you know, that to which, you know, other prescriptions, other medications are that kind of scrutiny they're not really subjected to.
Well, that's true. And that's why it's important, for FDA drugs, FDA approved drugs to be used for, health needs and for executions. When sodium thiopental became unavailable, states then looked to using pentobarbital. When the manufacturer of pentobarbital found out that the drug was being used in executions, it put distribution agreements in place so that its distributors could not sell the drug to departments of corrections.
So this was a personal management decision from the company that manufactures the drug. They just said, we don't want this used in, you know, we don't want this medicine used to kill people.
Yes.
So where does that bring us to now? What is the current most commonly available medicine or drug cocktail, I think it's called, that's available in Arizona?
Well, states are doing two things. They are either going to compounding pharmacies and asking the compounding pharmacies to mix up a batch of pentobarbital, or they're experimenting with other drug combinations. And that's what the state of Ohio did in January of this year and what Arizona did in the Joe Wood execution.
Now, when you talk about compounding pharmacies, you're talking about, I mean, these are, you know, my understanding of compounding pharmacies is these are usually small, you know, family-owned enterprises. They're not by any means these sort of, you know, larger Johnson & Johnson-esque labs that we envision when we think about medications being fabricated. What are these compounding pharmacies like that they contracted with?
Well, I mean, the sizes vary. There are the mom and pop size compounding pharmacies, and there are some that are bigger that make larger quantities of drugs. But basically, what's required is a doctor writes a prescription for a patient. The patient goes to the pharmacy, or someone from his or her family goes to the pharmacy to pick up the drug, and then the patient uses the drug. So you have
Sure.
a relationship between a doctor, a pharmacist, and a patient.
Right.
But when it comes to lethal injection, that relationship doesn't exist.
It can't, right? I mean, doctors can't, for the most part, doctors run great risk if it's learned that they participated in the lethal injection process because they can be, you know, censured or sanctioned by their licensing agencies.
Well, that depends on the state. A number of states have provisions that protect the licenses of anyone who participates in executions. In Arizona, for instance, a doctor or a pharmacist or an EMT who participates in an execution cannot lose his or her license.
And that's the result of a code that was passed or a measure that was passed? Or?
A statute passed by the
Fascinating.
Legislature.
It's mind-boggling that the state has the power to take it away from national licensing agencies of professionals, especially healthcare professionals. So, can you take us to what the state well, explain what a death cocktail is, because it's a term that I read about, and then take us to what the status of the death cocktail environment was in early January.
Well, Ohio was the first state to use a combination of hydromorphone and midazolam. That had never been used in an execution before, and the state came up with a formula that was used in the execution of Dennis McGuire, and it took Mr. McGuire over 26 minutes to die. He was struggling during the execution, and that was documented by the witnesses, the media witnesses to the execution. So fast forward to Arizona in July of this year. Arizona said it was going to use the same formula.
Before you go into, because I definitely want you to go into, you know, what happened, can you just let us know you know, who was Joseph R. Wood, when you met Joseph R. Wood, and yeah, those are the first two questions.
Joseph Wood was convicted in 1989 of killing his girlfriend and her father. There's no question as to his guilt. Joe had been on death row for 25 years, and his case made its way through through the various stages of the appeals, and we were appointed 10 weeks before Mr. Wood's execution.
Now, when's the first time that you met him, if I may ask?
I met him in April.
And if you're just joining us, this is Wallach on Law, our guest, Dale Baich. He was and he's talking to us about lethal injections and the July 23rd execution of Mr. Wood in Arizona. So you have this concern about what these what this new combination of medications might do, how it might pan out during the execution itself. What could a lawyer in that position do? What channels are available? What can you do?
Well, the first thing we did was we asked the Department of Correction for the name of the manufacturer of the drugs, the lot number of the drugs, the national drug code number. We asked for the qualifications of the persons who would be carrying out the execution, and finally asked how the Department of Corrections came up with the formula that it intended to use.
And what was the response? What responses did you get?
Basically, go pound sand.
Really?
We were stonewalled. The Department of Corrections did tell us that it was using hydromorphone and midazolam, that the drugs were FDA approved, and that the drugs did not were unexpired drugs. So that's all we knew.
Unbelievable. So you're talking to a correctional facility that's charged with taking care of people whose liberty we've taken away. You're asking them really simple questions like, hey, listen, do you have the right medicines? Are these medicines good? Is this going to work? And the response to you is essentially, we're not going to tell you it's covered. It's just covered. I don't want to put words in your mouth, but it just seems like these are really fundamental questions that someone should be obligated to answer before they take a human life, and it doesn't sound like those answers were provided to you.
They weren't provided to us, and they weren't provided to the public either. The act of carrying out the death sentence and an execution is probably the most severe act that government takes in the name of the people. And, certainly the citizens should know how the state is conducting the public's business, and are they using qualified individuals to do it? Are the drugs that are being used the right drugs? So it's not only the prisoner who has the right to know, it's the public.
Sure, absolutely. I mean, this is being done exactly right. It's being done in our name, and when it goes poorly or inhumanely or evilly, I think that might that reflects as it goes on us as a society. It's a reflection of ourself, and it must have been incredibly frustrating.
It was, and we didn't send just one letter. We sent a series of letters, and finally it got to the point where we decided to go to court. So Joe Wood and five other Arizona death row prisoners filed a lawsuit claiming that they had a First Amendment right to the information about the drugs and qualifications. And that the state was basically conducting human experimentation in violation of the Food, Drug, and Cosmetics Act by not running proper drug trials with this new formula.
I just listening to this for the first time, and this sounds like horrific and horrific and ghastly allegations, and B, the truth. I mean, it sounds like a pretty effective, efficient summary of what the state was doing when it's getting ready to undo life.
Right, right.
But like later on, my wife, she's going to listen to the show. She's going to ask me. She's going to say, don't talk about the law. Ian, I'm not a lawyer. I want to know what happened on July 23rd. I want to know why, what happened, and why it went wrong, and if there's anything we can do differently. Would you mind telling me about your day on July 23rd? Like when you got to the court, what happened, where you went, where you walked, what you saw?
Sure. The simple answer is, we don't know exactly what happened, and we don't know exactly why it happened the way that it did, and that's going to play out over time. The day started off with Mr. Wood having a visit from his spiritual advisor and his two CJA panel lawyers.
And for those of you who are listening who don't know, CJA is the Criminal Justice Act. These are lawyers that are appointed by a federal court, or the state usually has an equivalent, to represent someone who can't afford their own attorney through all stages of the criminal defense process.
So the lawyers had a visit, at about 9:20, the Arizona Supreme Court issued a temporary stay of execution. We raised an issue in state court the night before the execution about the experimentation issue. So there was a very short stay that was in place. I think it lasted for an hour and a half. The stay was lifted, and the process began at about 1:20 in the afternoon.
So there was like a four-hour period where the state court had said, look, we're not going to go ahead and kill someone. And then was it the state court that lifted it, or was it – when you say that lifting a stay, that means – a stay just means we're going to stop the process. Lifting the stay means, okay, we're not stopping the process anymore. It's going to keep going.
Correct.
Who lifted the stay? Was it the state court itself, or was it a
– it was the Arizona Supreme Court that lifted the stay.
Okay.
So the witnesses were – assembled in various staging areas and escorted into the witness room. Once the witnesses were all assembled, two TV monitors came on, and we saw Joe Wood laying on the gurney strapped to it. And
when you say he's strapped, just so I get sort of a strong visual image, when he's strapped to it, is he strapped, is it one strap? Is he strapped across his chest? Is he strapped across his legs, or his hands strapped?
He was strapped across his chest, his torso, and his legs.
Okay.
And the witnesses observed two members of the IV team assess his veins and insert the lines. Lines were inserted in about 10 minutes, one in each arm. And once the lines were secure, the curtains opened, and Mr. Wood had an opportunity to make a last statement.
And did he by chance, or...?
He did. He thanked his defense team and his family, and he acknowledged his Christianity. He was born again in 2009, when he was done with his last words, the execution process began. What we saw was Mr. Wood laying on the gurney, his eyes closed, and his breathing got very shallow. After about 4 or 5 minutes, one of the IV team members walked into the chamber, assessed consciousness. An announcement was made that Joe Wood was sedated. And we were watching him on the table. He was motionless for about 5 minutes after the consciousness check. And at one point, his mouth opened very wide, and he raised up against the straps, and it looked like he was trying to breathe. A minute passed, and he did that again. And another minute passed, and he did it again, and then started gasping and gulping.
Oh, my God.
Probably 10 times per minute, and that lasted for an hour and 40 minutes.
Oh, my God. That's terrifying.
It was very difficult to watch. After about 45 minutes, I gave a note to one of the lawyers who was in the room with me and told her to call the office, tell the office A, B, and C, and the office would know what to do. She was able to do that, and what the lawyers and staff in our office did was, within 10 minutes, prepared a pleading that was filed in 4 different courts, and we had hearings while the execution was going on in the federal district court and the Arizona Supreme Court.
This is supposed to be a process that's supposed to take minutes. During this process, not only were you able to acknowledge that this was beyond messed up, but you were able to compile, get to court, and actually have arguments. This is supposed to be a 2-second process. I mean, it's amazing that you did this, but I can't imagine what that experience. Will you tell us what was that experience like for you?
Well, I remained in the witness room. Viewing the execution, and the lawyers in our office were making arguments to the court, and the transcript of the argument in federal court is somewhat chilling to read. You know, the judge was asking very appropriate questions of our lawyer and the attorney general, and the attorney general was stepping out of his office to talk to the director of the Department of Corrections on another phone, and then relaying that information to the judge. The Department of Corrections, to our knowledge, did not take any steps to try and stop this. But instead, and we found this out a week later, administered 15 doses of the drug to Joe Wood.
And what physically happened to him? I mean, what did you see when that happened?
We were not able to tell when the doses were being administered because they're administered through long tubes that are in an adjacent room, so the witnesses didn't know that more drugs were being administered.
I mean, the idea for people to acknowledge, oh my God, we're doing something that's not working, let's do it 15 times over, is flawed to begin with.
Especially when you say that one dose will do the trick.
Right.
One dose is enough kill a human being, and it takes 15 doses to finally do it. And the whole process lasted close to 2 hours.
Unbelievable. Now, if you're just joining us, we have about 5 minutes left. This is Ian Wallach. It's Wallach on Law. I'm speaking with Dale Baich about lethal injections and the execution, the botched execution of Mr. Wood in July of this year. And we say it ended. I mean, did it end with did he stop writhing and then just relax? I mean, I hate to ask you to go into a morbid description of it, but I want to know what happened.
Well, during the hour and 40 minutes, I want to be clear. He wasn't writhing the whole time. There were points when he would raise up against the restraining straps, but he was mostly like gulping and gasping for air, trying to breathe. And after about an hour and 40 minutes, slowed down, and he finally stopped breathing for the second time, and the IV team member called death.
Okay. Now, I mean, this is a. First of all, I'm very glad that there are people like you who are willing to go into this area that's just so gray and so dark and. Do their best to make sure that it's done to the safest or best or most human extent possible. Thank you for that. Some people out there really believe that the death penalty is essential. Other people don't. I don't believe in it, but I find it very, very troubling. But if it's going to have to be done, it's you're right that it's going to have to be done well, and because of the not freaking out the witness factor of death by lethal injection, it seems like that method's probably going to stick around for a little while. What can we do to try to make it at least function the way it's supposed to? And I know some people can make jokes and say, well, it's supposed to kill a person, but what can we do in a way that wouldn't be so inhuman or potentially even embarrassing to us? What can we do to try to make this procedure better?
Well, I think what's most important is to be transparent about it. Public money is being spent to carry out the executions. We should know where the states are getting the drugs, what are the qualifications of the individuals doing this, and how are the states coming up with these formulas? Is it the warden and a couple of his or her deputies sitting in a back room saying, well, I think this will work? Are they consulting with medical doctors, anesthesiologists, other medical professionals to come up with this formula? We just don't know. And where are they getting the drugs? That's important, too. Drugs can be adulterated. Drugs could be diverted. We need to make sure there's a proper chain of custody of the drugs that are being used. So I think bringing more transparency to the process would go a long way toward making it safer.
That makes a ton of sense. Listen, Mr. Baich, thank you so much for taking time out of your schedule, and I'm incredibly sorry that you experienced what you did by seeing that. I'm very thankful that we have people like you who are willing to take this task on. So thank you for doing what you're doing, and also thank you for spending time today, helping us sort of understand the scope of and what lethal injections are and what steps might be taken to get it in the right direction. Thank you.
Well, thank you for your kind words and for having me on your show. Thank you, Ian.
Okay, well, that's going to wrap up the show. Thank you guys for listening and for just partaking in this dialogue. A very special thank you to our guests, Jane Velez Mitchell and Dale Baich. Listen, if you're out there and you want to send me your thoughts, either thoughts about things that we did go over or talk about here or things that we should talk about, go ahead and send them to me. Send them to me at change@renovatejustice.com. And renovatejustice.com, that's a blog that I keep on things that just that maybe need some revisiting in the world of criminal justice. I also have a blog on various trials. That's trialfiend.com. And if you want to contact me, you can contact me at the law offices of Ian Wallach or at wallachlegal.com. As always, a very special thank you to my producers in New York, Mark Goldman and Ryan McCormick. You guys are great. And that's pretty much going to wrap it up. Just thank you guys for joining. Please remember, let's keep using our heads. Let's stop using our hate. And I'll talk to you next week.